glad to see you all here in our Near Lounge powered by Near UA. We're about to start with our speakers. It's the best part of our lounge, I would say. And I'm happy to present you our first speaker, Marieke Flament, CEO of Near Foundation, with the talk Building Beyond the Hub. Hype. Feel funky, y'all.
Hello, welcome on boat. I love what's written outside here. Bienvenue, that's how we say in French. It's amazing to see so many of you. And to our Ukrainian friends, thank you so much for organizing this event, which looks extremely promising. I think you're going to learn a ton of things about NIR and what it means to actually build on NIR over the next couple of days and the next couple of sessions. And so what I want to talk about today is building beyond the hype. And actually, before doing that, I want to take a step back, or rather, a step out of this boat. What's happening right now in the world is a sliding door moment. It's a turning point in history on many, many fronts. On one point, our planet is burning. You just need to look outside to see that the temperatures that we're seeing are just not right. I'm coming out of London. It was the same thing. Our cities are just not made for actually handling that heat. And literally, forests, the remaining forests we have in Europe, are burning. The second part is actually there is still a very long, damaging war on the European territory. And more than ever, actually, we are seeing a divide between the West and the East. We are seeing a divide between the left and the right. Our society is completely being polarized. The trust in our government, in our institutions, seems to be eroding. You're in France. The French president was, recently, we're good? Okay, the French president was recently elected, but guess what? He doesn't have the assembly of the parliament. He probably will not be able to do much. Some will say it's a good mark of democracy. Some will say actually the system is broken. The reality is something is just not right. We are out of COVID, or are we out of COVID? And if anything, what's the next thing that's actually gonna loom on us? What's the next pandemic that's gonna actually impact us? COVID has left major marks, not only on our mental health, but also actually on progress made for decades, for example, for women's rights. Stats show that during COVID, it's women who took the lion's share of looking after kids in the home. And you just need to look at what happened with abortion rates in the US. Oh my God, this so no. Do we have a mic? No. Okay, I'll keep going. Sorry about that. That's part of testing and learning. Women's rights. Abortion law, what's happening in the US? Amazing. Thank you. Women's rights. What's happening right now in the US? That's like wiping off decades of progress that were made. And when you look at COVID, actually, remember the beginning when governments were actually, I would say, recklessly printing money. Where is the money coming from? And we were told and promised that there will be no inflation. Well, look at where we're at today. I don't know how many of you got out to buy a pain au chocolat and a bad coffee. I don't think French people know how to do good coffee. But that is like €6.50. Who can afford €6.50? You can here, but people outside cannot. So inflation is ramping up, and there is no doubt that there is a major recession looming on us. Layoffs are already starting to happen. More layoffs will happen. So all of that, and all of that is, of course, super linked. And by the way, our industry has its share of problems in it. It seems that we didn't really learn about what happened in 2008, and we're just making the same mistakes. All of that is linked. It's happening. It's happening really, really fast. And I don't know about you, but when I start making the connections and looping the dot, I find it scary. But I think it's actually time to act. And I think we have in our hands the technology, and we have in our hands the knowledge and the power to change that. You have that. You can do that, each one of us. So my ask, when you think about this couple of days that you're spending here with amazing people, my ask is that you think about what you're going to build, is that you build with your heart, and that is that you build for your moms, for your non-crypto friends, that you build stuff that the world can really understand, stuff that we've promised, and things that can actually really create the open, more fair and more transparent world that we begin in. And when you do that, please do it on NIR. So now, let's get on to NIR. What is NIR? It's a big question, right, Illia? What is NIR? So what is NIR? At NIR, that's what we believe in. We believe in a world where people can control their assets, their data, and their power of governance, an open web world. Everything is centered around our technology, and NIR is a protocol. And that protocol is simple, it's scalable, and it's secure. The simplicity is absolutely fundamental. It's simple so that users can use it. It's simple so that developers can actually use it. Whether you like it or not, JavaScript has tens of millions of developers that can actually start coding on it. And because it's simple, scalable, and secure, it's also enabling us to actually be truly sustainable. And that means that actually when building solutions that will actually help solve climate challenges that we have, that can be done on Near as a protocol. The Near ecosystem is broad, it's big, it's actually growing extremely fast. And at the center of the Near ecosystem, you have the Near protocol. Around it, you have different parts of the infrastructure, which I'm delighted to know that you'll actually learn more about over the next couple of days. The way we think about projects being built is that you have projects that are built around DeFi, projects that are built for creators, and projects that are built to actually help collective organizations be self-organized and get together. DeFi is a fundamental pillar. Without DeFi, without finance, there is no functioning economy. And so today, that's what the topic is about. In terms of numbers, just a couple of numbers to highlight. We have now over 16 million active wallets, a community that is continuously ever-growing, a number of projects that is also continuously scaling up, and a number of regional hubs that are also scaling up to help reach more and more people, not just in English, but in more different languages. So when you think about this future that we have in our hands and how we can actually create a better, fairer, more open world and better place because of this sliding door moment that we're living, what does this mean and how can you actually think about it? Well, three things. We need to rethink ownership, we need to rethink community, and we need to rethink what incentives mean. Ownership, a couple of examples of what we're starting to see on Near, which we think is actually extremely interesting. You, Minter, can you flip Instagram on its head? And can you actually completely rethink from A to Z what it means to be an influencer and really own your account and the data and the content you're creating? We've done an integration with Brave Wallet for Aurora. Well, what if you want to keep actually your privacy and decide what you're watching and what actually it gives you as rewards? Tamago, reinventing what Spotify and music could be doing. And actually Nearpay, reinventing banking. So that's what some of the examples that we are seeing for ownership. In terms of community, again, here, super happy to see that this is one of our top regional hubs that has taken the lead to organize an event in Paris. But communities are fundamental. Ultimately, speaking English is a major privilege, and I'm sure here most of you are not English native speakers. The reality is that if you speak in your own native language, you will be better understood. You'll have more chances of actually raising funds or finding partners to build a project. And actually, you'll know the local problems that need to be tackled. That's why local communities are extremely important and part of the Near ecosystem. We have communities that actually range from Kenya to Latin America to now Ukrainian hub in exile in Portugal and in the Balkans and so on and so forth. Rethinking actually communities enable people to get together and vote on things and do things way faster than anything that was possible before. Unchained DAO has been a spectacular example of how actually an ONG can be created in less than 2 hours to really get firms from A to Z in a war zone and extremely fast to help relief. Rethinking communities also, how can we rethink fandom? In the sports industry, there is so many things of what does it mean to own a team? We're partnering with CellGP to think through, can a DAO buy a real, true sports team that is actually a professional sports team? And Niche is also rethinking communities around what does it mean to actually reinvent what some of the social media players would be out there. The last part is incentives. How can you actually rethink incentives? Some will say the X to earn movement is dead. I think it's far from that. I actually think we're just at the beginning of it. And if you rethink completely what does it mean to do something, to earn something, then you really start reinventing our society. You really start thinking, what are we spending our time on? And actually, what's the true human potential? What should we be doing? The 9-to-5 job is definitely completely dead, but what does that mean and how can you actually empower ourselves through that? Sweatcoin, an example, you work, you earn. You can learn on Near Club and actually be rewarded for what you want to actually learn. And if you plant a tree with OFP, you can actually also earn. So those are just some of the examples of things that we're thinking, and I hope can actually help you think that through. So if you want to build beyond the hype, and if you actually want to take your share and help in this sliding door moment, and this is not something that others will solve, the moment we are living through in history is for future generations, and each and every one of you can actually participate and has a share to do something.
If you want to continue that journey, I also highly encourage you to join us at NearCon, which will be in Lisbon between the 11th and the 14th of September. And I will leave you with that. Those next couple of days, the connections, the people you're going to meet, take a step back and try to think about the impact of what you're going to do. And try to think about actually what is it that you're building that is truly enabling us to actually show to the world the promises of Web3 and the open web. Thank you very much. Feel real funky, y'all.
Thank you so much, Marie. And I'm going to present you our second speaker, Illia Polosukhin, co-founder of Near. We talk what to build in DeFi.
Thank you, thank you. Hey, everyone. I see people are really scared, and so everybody's really far. You know, there's seats in front. Okay, I'm not going to bite. So, welcome, everyone. Thanks, Marieke, for inspirational, but also linking to the real world. I think we're missing a lot of it in crypto, where we kind of talk, you know, our own language. We talk about our own problems and not really usually linking it to the things that are happening outside. So now we talk about our own world, DeFi. You know, the traditional finance is already broken. We know that. So how do we improve on that? So Near, kind of, you know, designed to be simple, secure, scalable. But at the core of it, right, it's about usability. It's about being able to be accessed by, you know, billions of people around the world. And this is kind of the core concept. Like, it doesn't matter what we build if nobody's using it, right? It doesn't matter how technically, you know, sound and decentralized and awesome it is. If, you know, our friends, our family, you know, people outside of this boat cannot use it. And so that's really what we kind of started to, like, started out when we were trying to build Near, is how do we build this such that regular people that are not technical, that potentially don't even know that, you know, internet is not Facebook, are able to use this. And so there are kind of two phases of getting there, right? The first phase, I mean, outside of building infrastructure and all the, you know, complex stuff that mostly done, is even more complex part is actually getting people to use this, right? So first part is pretty much bridging this gap of Web2 to Web3, right? Is giving some immediate value that users can kind of tangibly perceive such that they will take this jump. And to be clear, like, this is a jump, right? That's why I do mention security, because right now blockchain is perceived insecure. And by the way, all of the stuff that happened in past months is not helping, although most of it have nothing to do with blockchain, right? It's mostly having to do with all the usual traditional finance stuff. But people perceive it as insecure, as, you know, hackable, as what if I lose my seed phrase. And we need to solve that through usability, through education, through building products that actually deliver value where people will kind of activate and switch. And same time, we need to go beyond that, right? Beyond what people are doing now into use cases that, you know, you cannot do. And, like, if you think of generally what blockchain is really good at is opening markets. It's the idea that anything and anywhere can be a market that you can open up, that you can create liquidity on, and that is available to everyone in the world, right? And obviously, like, you know, tokens and NFTs, like JPEGs, is kind of examples of this, but it can be, you know, an education market, it can be an insurance market, it can be anything that you can imagine, right? It can be a water market for Africa that you can build, and everybody in the world can participate in it, right? And that's what, you know, the value we can generate and kind of unlock. And so finances have been, you know, reasonably so the first use case that kind of makes sense because, well, finances is about markets. It kind of has a direct alignment. You know, if you open up a new market of, you know, new assets or new tokens or new JPEGs, people will, you know, pour on it and try to speculate on it and try to figure out. And so there's still kind of, you know, a lot to do with the people who are able to do it efficiently are people who probably have been doing it in traditional finance. But, you know, we're trying to lower the bar. We're trying to make it accessible, and there's more and more people trying it. And this is why, again, how to make it more usable. And so DeFi is really this opportunity for everyone to participate. So why DeFi on Near, right? There is, you know, a lot of blockchains, there's a lot of kind of already existing financial infrastructure that exists on Ethereum. And so the answer is actually not usability yet. And we need to get there. But right now, you know, the things are kind of on the technical pieces that we already have there is the fact that Near has the fastest finality and kind of, you know, one of the fastest block time, which means your transactions, you know, settle right away. You have the scalability that allows you to keep adding more applications, keep adding more kind of capabilities without, you know, bogging down kind of others, right? Like happens on every single non-sharded chain. And the reality is, if your app is that successful, you actually can have your own capacity, right? So if you think of it, you can actually get a full chain of capacity on Near if your app needed it. And so Aurora is a good example because Aurora has actually been binded to a separate shard. So it has up to a full chain of capacity, as if Aurora launched its own Cosmos chain. But they did not need to launch anything. They did not need to configure anything. They did not need to change anything. This was just the governance decision to allocate them the full shard. And so you can have that ability without changing anything for your users and for your kind of interactions. You also have contracts that are asynchronous, meaning, like on one side, this has limitations, especially in finance. On the other side, it's naturally cross-chain because there is no difference between calling another contract on the same on Near or calling another contract in Ethereum or in Solana because you have already all of the cross-chain kind of asynchronicity embedded into the protocol. We also have native meta transactions coming. And so this gets closer to the usability part because at the end, users don't want to see the kind of implementation detail of the blockchain, right? Like the fact that the fees are structured in this or that way is our problem, not the user's problem, right? And so as a developer, as a kind of application, you should hide it from. And again, Aurora has already prototyped this and showed this because they have native meta transactions. They allow users to not pay for transaction fees up to a limit. And so we're kind of bringing that together with Aurora to native Near to all the applications. And you have programmable accounts. Again, Near accounts are not just, you know, kind of your public key, private key pair. It's actually pretty much a smart contract. It can be an empty smart contract with a lot of keys, with different permissions. You can program them in any way, right? Your account can be your vault that exercises some specific trading strategy, some specific, you know, kind of saving strategy, whatever that is. And you can build applications that program users' accounts. And so kind of hide a lot of complexity from the user and at the same time give them the power to choose which strategies they want to execute. Beyond that, kind of what's coming is remote accounts. So this is the idea that you actually, as a user, don't really, really care about what chain you're using, right? You have assets, you have wallets, and you have apps, and you want to use them, right? You go to an app, you open it up, and for some reason, it only supports, you know, wallets from another chain. That seems really weird if you think from a user that's coming from Web2. So going beyond this, and on Near, you can already do this to some extent, and we're expanding this. You can actually log in with whatever wallet you want, right? With Ethereum wallet, with Solana wallet, kind of Ethereum-like wallet, MetaMask, etc. You can start using the app. Underneath, it will actually bridge stuff directly to your kind of virtual account, remote account on Near. You will use the app, and you will, you know, get bridged back whatever is left, right? The example that's already kind of using this model and going to be launching soon is Orderly. Is the order book DAX where you will be able to log in with whatever wallet, with MetaMask, et cetera, without changing the network. You're still on Ethereum. You still don't think about the other network. You will, say, deposit your funds. It will bridge it underneath, and you can use this app, right? You don't need to think that, oh, I need to create a Near account, bridge to it, and then use the app. Like, that whole pass is not needed. And so this can allow you to create apps that don't feel foreign to the user that comes from the other chain. So this expands kind of your user base to everyone who has any wallet in and that supports meta transactions from other chains to your apps. And so that allows to truly kind of build apps that you know, are multi-chain, cross-chain, whatever you want to call it, but at the end, they deliver value to the user. So what are the pieces of the ecosystem, right? There's a bunch of pieces, and I'll just cover a few, but the important piece is kind of, it's based off, you know, connecting to real world, right? And sort of there are a few pieces that connect to real world. One is kind of crypto bank, you know, on-ramp, off-ramp. There's Nearpay and a few others who are building this. Like, at the end, your Near account should be your bank account, right? If you think of it, you can actually give, with keys on Near, you can have a key that a crypto bank has that does not have custody. They're not able to move your assets, but they are able to recover your other key. They're able to recover your account if you lose your access key, for example, your seed phrase. And at the same time, they allow to do, for example, issue a card that you can use right in the store. So you could actually have an IBAN that maps to your Near account that allows you to go in and out. You have a card, and you have ability to recover your keys, right? So on one side, you have the banking infrastructure. On the other side, it's not custodial. They're not able to steal your money or lend it off to someone without your consent and understanding of the risks. And the other side of this is real-world assets, right? Like, right now, we're playing in our own sandbox, right? We're creating tokens, and then we start, you know, trading and leveraging on them, and then, you know, we pull in a bunch of stable coins to leverage on top of them. And this is all cool, but, you know, it all kind of very self-referential. And so to go beyond that, what you truly need is real-world assets. You need the assets that are kind of coming from real world, right? The water, the boats, the real estate, the commodities, the equities, et cetera. And so we need to have this connection to the kind of to the real world assets, bring them on chain. Because at the end, the traditional finance and kind of DeFi will merge into one, right? There's no way that the current infrastructure that, you know, banks and prime brokerages and NASDAQ are using is going to be better than this infrastructure we're building that's literally, you know, smartest people in the world are pouring in and, you know, building. So what should you build, right? There are a few things that are, like, clearly, I mean, there's a bunch more that that out there, but one of the biggest things is insurance, right? Again, if we're thinking of, like, what unlocked kind of banking and traditional finance back in the day is actually FDIC-like insurance, right? It's the ability to know that if you put up to some amount of money, they actually are insured by quote-unquote government. And so there is a kind of similar approach here that people can take and allowing to have some limit of insurance for kind of, you know, for the masses, for retail. It's not going to insure, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars, but it can insure, you know, some amount of money on every account or in every kind of within every app. And that will unlock a ton of kind of, you know, reduce the risk that people are taking and the shakiness of our ecosystem. On the other side, I mentioned real world assets, right? Again, this is like we're just missing so much of the economy, right? There's like tens of trillions of dollars every day being transacted by traditional finance in real assets, like, I mean, outside of blockchain, and so we need to bring them on, we need to unlock it, and guess what? There will be actually more liquidity because by opening up these markets, right, removing the fact that you can only trade for whatever, 8 hours equities, right, removing the fact that you need to have a US brokerage account to buy it, like removing all those limitations will create more volume, will create more liquidity. Trade finance, so if people are not familiar, the way that all of the trade works is somebody invoices stuff, people ship things, it takes weeks to months to deliver, and then they pay, right? There's actually a liquidity split that happens between these two sides. Anywhere you have liquidity split, you have a market, right? Somebody can buy this now and receive money later and buy it at a discount. Again, this market right now is not, like, it either doesn't exist or very limited. Opening it up, creating it, you know, turning invoices NFTs that anybody can buy and kind of receive the payment later, and, you know, bundling it into insurance, bundling it together, will open up, again, huge kind of liquidity in this, but in turn actually can help with some of our supply chain problems that we're having, because right now some of the people are just not able to pay for things because the supply chain got longer. And the end derivatives, right? Again, this is kind of how all this world was built is as you have all of the pieces, you now can build derivatives on this, and pretty much that, again, creates more liquidity in the market. Now, the benefit of derivatives on-chain versus off-chain is that you do need to post your collateral. And so if your collateral, if you go under market, it actually will, it will be sold, which as we've seen with some recent things, people actually need to close their DeFi loans even if they can file for bankruptcy for their CeFi loans. So at the end, like, we're building this infrastructure. It's pretty much will mirror a lot of the traditional finance because that makes sense, but it will be done in a different way because we have now kind of enforceable things. You cannot hide under, you know, your company's books and kind of create some machination around it and, you know, take risks that are not kind of evaluated and visible to everyone. And so I encourage you to stick around. There's a proximity team here who has a lot more ideas what to build. They also, you know a lot of teams in DeFi and in Near that, and can connect you. There's tons to build, and welcome here. Thanks, everyone.
Yeah, thank you so much. Please, don't go. Thank you. I think everybody inspired. Now we have some ideas what to build in DeFi, and we have guys from Near Grants team, so all set to build your DeFi product on this board. maybe someone have some questions to Illia, please. I can give you a micro. Just raise your hand.
Hi, Illia. My name is Oyin. I'm currently building something called NeoDApp, which essentially connects creators, users, and brands together. And one of the things for us is that we're trying to onboard non-crypto and non-Web3 natives on the platform because a lot of my friends are influencers. One of the problems that we found is how mobile-friendly our dApp can be. So what is Near doing to make sure that we even optimize the mobile-friendly version of Near? Because we're building on Near because it's the most mobile-friendly, but how do we even optimize that even further?
Yeah, so there are a few problems with mobile in general, right? So first of all is the security part. So right now, the neither of the phones, because they are U.S. companies, can use the curves, the crypto curves that we're using in blockchain. And so there's a little bit of a tension between these two things where the crypto does not want to agree with the curves that are approved by NSA, and like U.S. companies are not able to use crypto that is not approved by, I mean, the government in general. And so the balance here is because Near actually allows to change keys and swap keys is to add the NIST curves, the curves that are approved by U.S. government, and allow people who want to use it, right, to come in and onboard with that, with native, for example, cryptography that is in the phones, right, within secure enclaves. And then pretty much if they don't want it later, they can actually remove it, right? They can kind of turn it out. So that's kind of a trade-off of usability versus, you know, some crypto anarchy that exists in this space. The other one has been, from the beginning, is by kind of going web route, we have decided to not be at the whim of the, you know, stores, Apple Store and Google Store. And I think right now, especially, it's really hard for apps to go through, especially if you're dealing with NFTs. Apple is pretty much not allowing anything to go through. And so that's why web is pretty much the only way right now to do it, and Near has been, like, probably the only chain that you are able to do this with mobile app. So adding this idea, so with, for example, Safari and a few other browsers, they added this ability to do web auth using the NIST curve. So if we do that, then there will be kind of more flexibility. You also have Magic, magic.link. So magic.link allows you to onboard with the email. It is a kind of somewhat custodial option, right, because they store your private key on the HSM in their kind of servers. And so, again, if you're talking about onboarding new people, that's probably the easiest way because they can just like enter the email, onboard, don't need to think about the key, and then later, again, because Near allows you to turn off, you can actually, you know, secure it with a ledger later for the same account. And that's probably is the most kind of powerful feature is like you can onboard people into less secure options and then let them to offboard into more security. And then beyond that, I mean, so people have launched a few of the mobile wallets already. So Finer wallet is on Apple Store now. And there's like few more apps are launching. So I think with more and more of these things that go through, we'll have kind of more understanding what is the missing piece. So there's, I think Swift and Android SDK have been built as well. So for developers to actually do build native apps. And so like I think over time, we'll get more and more kind of the support. But I think the corner piece here is this, like the NIST curve and meta transactions. I think meta transactions also like allowing apps to pay for users and kind of hide a lot of the blockchain transaction flow, again, before users are ready for that.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more question if someone wants.
Hi, so MEV enthusiast here. Personal question, do you think meta transactions could help sort of define protocol layer MEV for Near?
I think so, yeah. I think Aurora is actually already experimenting with Sounds, where it's pretty much like offers transactions for specifically backgrounds. And so for those who doesn't know, background means like when you send a transaction, like as if you're doing buying something, on AMM, there is a backward kind of transaction to rebalance AMM that will happen because like you moving the price a little bit and somebody will move the price back. And so this always happens. There's people constantly spamming the chain with these transactions. And so the idea is to offer that as a service where you're kind of providing that as a kind of automatic thing when you submit transaction. And so I think like, yes, meta transactions will become kind of a flow for layers almost to make money as a way to, subsidize what they're doing.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Illia, for your answer.
Thank you. What you want, I've gotta know.
What you want, I've gotta know. And I'm happy to present you our next speaker, Evgeny Kuzyakov, co-founder of Proximity, and Evgeny will tell us about social in Web3.
I'm Evgeny Kuzyakov, and I'm here to talk about social in Web3. And it's an exploration how we get there, and it will talk about near.social and beyond this. So first, let's start with the question, what's the difference between a blockchain and Web3? So it's written in Rust, it's a blockchain. If it's written in PowerPoint, it's Web3. So my background is I worked at Google Plus when it started, and later I joined Facebook to work on VR, and eventually I joined Near as one of the founding engineers, and currently I'm on Proximity. We focus on DeFi, but today I'm going to talk more about social than on DeFi. So why Near Protocol? It has a lot of benefits, and it has named accounts, which is you don't have to buy your ENS, multiple keys per account, and soon, I guess, remote accounts, which would be great. An account may have a contract, and there's also a simple JSON API that front-end developers can use, and contracts talk to each other also through JSON. There's a storage on the contract side that is kind of costing you 1 year to store 100 kilobytes, and that allows us to scale more on storage rewrites instead of like expanding the cost of every transaction to allocate new storage. So Near is scalable. It has a free public RPC, so you don't have to worry about how you started. And finally, I contributed to protocol, so it helped me to decide which one to build on. So there's going to be some social experiments on that I'm going to talk. So there's a freemium version that doesn't include some of them, and you'll probably skip them. But also, mostly we're going to focus on the social apps similar to social media. So first one going to be Near FM. It's a decentralized Twitter. And the idea here, you can actually build it on Near fairly easily. And there's a few features of this. So there's no backend on the Near FM. It means it's only a front-end app, and it uses a public archival RPC node. And this node is actually available to look on a data beyond the current state. So you can query a certain block at a certain height and ask what was the like state at the given height. So that allows you to basically come back in time and minimize the cost of the user data that they need to store. So there's a provable state because it's a blockchain. It also has no operational cost. It means as a developer, you don't need to pay for the running the service. It can be hosted on IPFS. The storage is covered by the users. And finally, there's the reads are free from the public RPC. It's also censorship resistant because so long as NEAR is censorship resistant, you can store them and put data so long as at least one validator approves this transaction and it gets into the chain. And it's also open sourced. So how it works, it basically is something called post chain, which is basically a chain of posts. So we only store the last post on a node, and the rest are linked through the block number. So you store the last post, then you keep the height at the previous post, and so on. So you can fetch it recursively, and you can also link to a particular height. So it has a problem that you cannot delete the post, because once it hit the blockchain, it's pretty much there forever. It also had a social graph where we store the bidirectional edges, and these edges are effectively covered by the users. So a user who initiates the edge covers the cost of the both edges. This graph is public and reusable, which means like any application on NEAR that deals with NEAR accounts can just read this data from the contract, and then it can expand it so it can be used for different applications than just Twitter. Finally, it has a feed, and the feed is takes your following edges, and then it expands the latest post for the every connection, and then you recursively fetch the rest on the front end. So why it didn't work completely, it's because likes require more storage than just a single action. So that would be permanent, and otherwise you cannot implement likes like a Twitter does, because you can like the same post like multiple times, for example. UI is hard, and all the improvements that happens here have to be on a contract level, and that's a problem. So finally, it was forked on a testnet, and we lost some state because the block heights were reset, and we linked by the heights. So the next one is the wiki. And the wiki is a wiki using Web 4. And I'm going to talk about what is Web 4. The idea here, it explores a similar idea from the Near FM. We can reuse similar tech for the wiki. You store the data on chain, and all the previous edits of the content, just basically outside of current state, only stored in the historical data. And you can create a permanent link to any of the versions, so you can say, okay, I want to put this data, don't want anyone to modify it. That's why it's linked by this post. So storage is shared, and it's covered by donation in respect to the Jimmy Wales, the original inventor of the donation for Wikipedia. It's also easy to use. So you basically create any page under the URL, and if the article doesn't exist, you can create one. If it exists, you can edit one. Use Markdown and only one transaction to actually post it, because the storage is covered. So once you sign up, it's good to go. And finally, Web 4. So this is the project that Vlad Gorchina is building. It's something average between what Jack Dorsey does, which Web 5 and like Web 3 that I'm talking. It hosts a front end on the contract side, either through a link to IPFS, or just you can actually keep static pages there and like JavaScript and service straight from the contract. So every dot near actually name gets the subdomain. So for example, the wiki.near gets the URL that you can visit, and it will read the data from the contract and retrieve it and render it for you. So it didn't work completely, but it works pretty well. So it doesn't have a reputation, so someone can come to any article and edit it in their way, and all you can do is like come back and like undo the edit, so like just another transaction. There is no reputation to restrict the edits, no permissions to do this, because someone can just claim a good URL and stay there forever, and you will never be able to edit this particular article. And it doesn't have good navigation and doesn't have a search, because it's mostly a front-end app as well, like without even front-end, just a contract. And final thing for today is a near social from the live experiment. So it's basically kind of centralized Twitter, but it's called federated. The idea here, we go to Web2, we launch the Mastodon instance that is on near social. It's free to use, so no one needs to pay for transaction. You log in with your .near account, and it creates a username for you. And it maps your .near account to the your this Web2 account, which can be later used through the API. And it also has push notifications. So when you log in with Near, you have a wallet. Then you basically get authorized, you create an account, and you have creds to log in on mobile as well. So once you get into Web2, we have a link to your, for example, alex.near. We'll have a link to at Alex on the that Near social. So you have profiles, social edges, your display name, which whatever you can post, and like all the post history can be exported and available through API. So the API is giving you this very fast from the memory that is refreshed like once a minute, and you can access it from any app. So the wiki actually uses this API from Near Social to render profiles of the people, and like you can also use the social graph, for example, to display like, hey, NFTs by friends. Finally, you have push notifications. So if you have a mobile app, you can make a certain transaction, such as like a post on wiki triggers an event, event picks by indexer, indexer posts to the another API server who like makes a message and tagging you on the near.social, and you get an instant push notifications from your Mastodon app. So it didn't work because it's too centralized. It failed the network effect because people don't want another Twitter. There's no incentive to join, and it's also not super composable and written in Ruby. So, how to iterate. So, next thing is social 7.0, because there was like six experiments before this. So, first we go to the Web2 world. So, you have the company that makes the application. User use this application, create data, and then data is owned by the company and used by the application. So if you have developers, they like back for the data and get interacted by the company because they don't give the API. So in Web3, you have start with developers who build the applications used by the users, create the data, but they also own the data, and data is used by applications, by developers, and the good part is like if it's open source, the application can be reused by the developers, and the company is just being said. So what social is, and I tried to answer this question through Googling it, but that's pretty much my ideas. It's what defines you, so your profile, identity, your biography, what's your connection, social graph, contacts, groups, what you kind of achieved, so badges, soulbound tokens, NFTs, achievements, then your communication. This is feeds like Twitter, there's blogs, there's like newsletters. Then once you add encryption, you can achieve private nodes, settings, like personalization. Once you have also encryption, you can do messaging that is private, and chat, emails, whatever. Finally, you can give some kind of weight to the reputation, and you can rank your connections locally, and then if the data is public, you can expand on this. and obviously notifications, which are important to get back to the info. So how we do this, we keep data on chain. It's basically going to be owned by the users. They cover storage. Everyone has access to the reading the data. If it's encrypted, it's not helpful for them. The permissions are controlled by the users. You have immutable data history. And the important, it also scales with the blockchain. This is actually the only technical slide, mostly. So to represent this data in a format that is works for everyone, we basically just don't need to have a format. It's freeform data organized in a tree for helpful splitting of the scope. The user covered the storage like before. It also can be linked to the historical edits. And it also can be sharded by the account ID. So on the right, you can see some of the examples how I envision the data may be stored. So for example, under alex.near, you have profile that explains the profile, then a graph, which can be like graph or like the follow edges. Then you have badges that Alex gave to someone else. You can have direct messages. And you can have a status, which is like a Twitter. So instead of going for a schema, we're going to have external standards. And external standards are a thing that people agree on, but don't have to be enforced on a contract level. If there's a, that's important because this external standard doesn't require on-chain governance to make a decision which standard is the one. You can have competing standards, and it's good for the ecosystem. So finally, a community will lead to someone that, okay, the profile is displayed this way, similar how, for example, an NFT standard exists. And it also allows you to iterate through idea, you build an MVP, you test it, and all after this, once you get to the point, you define a standard. It should have write permissions, which have a limited scope. So for example, front-end apps have this scope, contracts have that scope. You can do data-specific permissions and permissions for permissions. On the front-end side, you can have only front-end apps, so you can bring all the JavaScript developers who don't know how to write Rust contracts, and this is good. I'm also close to out of time, so I'll quickly skip through this to backend. So backend is what's using the standards. It's not the contract. It understands profile search. It can graph, do graph expansion, and it can be updated frequently. It also open sourced, so anyone can spawn their own backend. So here's how the architecture of this is going to look. You basically have on-chain contract or multiple contracts. They can interact with other contracts. You have front-end apps that read from chain, and they understand standards. Then you have an API backend that reads from chain, understands standards, and serves front-end to be a bit quicker. And other contracts can also like contribute there. So why it might work? It will create a network effect if it works. So data, applications, users, and developers kind of closing the loop. So the social graph is growing by developer, or like they use by developers to bootstrap new apps. Badges and achievements create engagement through the gamification. Users basically invite other users, so they join the network and get more people in, and developers build new apps that also bring users back. So every component is replaceable, which means no one kind of in control of one single piece that can bring it all down. There's no governance, there's no need for external token, and it's no operational cost. So if I die tomorrow and it's actually alive, it can go on without me. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Evgeny. I think we have time for one question, so just raise your hand if you have any questions. No? No questions so far?
Oh, soon. Trademark. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, go ahead.
I just want to know if the application of AI technologies on distributed social medias is possible. For example, on Twitter, based on what I'm looking for example, I was looking for near events.
Yeah.
Just eventually, I found the Solana event, and I'm very happy. So is it possible to use the AI technologies on distributed social networks.
Yeah, that's the goal, because like you can just get all the data, you can process the data and serve it easily. Like the problem is if Twitter would give you all the data, they wouldn't have nothing to like keep people in, because someone can launch an alternative. Here it's pretty much open Twitter, and the people likely, like it will be hard to build an app that is locks people in only in Europe with closed source, because someone will come in and build like a slightly better app or extension. And like for AI, you have access to all the data, unencrypted obviously, but it can definitely like possibly do. So yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Thank you so much, Evgeny. Before we're going to proceed with our next speakers,
well,
I just want to remind you, we will announce the results on 22nd of July. And I wanted to remind you that we are planning to have happy hours after our pitches with some drinks. So let's move on. Our next speakers, it's Mark Sugden, commercial consultant, and Denny Balon, product consultant of the Decentral Bank, with a talk, USN, Stability and Utility. Welcome.
Раз, два, три. Окей.
You could all hear me anyway, right? Yeah, exactly. Cool, so I'll let you start off with the intros. Denny, you're the main man.
Nice to see everybody here, and it's especially cool to see so many people, because on one hand we've got the crypto winter happening, on the other hand it's Horace Hell. I would have used the F word, but it's the H word. and transact you send on Near, and do vice versa. This will allow, among many other things, like locking a lot of liquidity from outside into the Near ecosystem, it will allow to make the payments happen as easy as transacting, I don't know, dollars from your Wise card to Wise card or Revolut, or from a Visa to a MasterCard. The story is about function over form. So USN is not another DeFi bubble product. USN is trustworthy with battle-proven stablecoins as collateral. It's extremely user-friendly and outstandingly highly liquid. These are the four key points that DCB pays attention to and does all the development, business-wise, marketing, and actual technical development, considering these points.
So something we're pretty proud of, the version 2 has been live around 4 weeks, give or take a few days. And we've already got 125 million circulating supply, which is quite good in these market conditions, right? As well as 3.5 million daily transactions. So that's something that we're very proud about as well. And of course, our good friends at Ref.Finance have a good stable pool going. I think that's out of date, actually. It's about 170 million or something like that there in the stable pool. So building up good liquidity with minimal slippage there, which is absolutely paramount to the long-term success of it. Now, last one, the call to action. Some of you guys are builders, some of you have projects already. Talk to us, you know, if you have our details, come and find us. We'll be floating around the boat. And talk to us about how you can integrate USN into your platform, payments app, or anything like that. And of course, if you're building a new project and you're raising money from VCs, ask for USN. Like, that's a given, right? Absolutely. So they need to provide liquidity so they can get USN, build up the ecosystem. Everyone wins, absolutely. The key thing here is USN is an ecosystem first project, right? Sure, Denny and I are helping Decentral Bank with USN, but it's Near first and foremost. This is for the strength of the wider ecosystem, and only by working together will we achieve the success that we really want to. So thanks very much for listening. I think we've got some time for two or three questions.
Do we have time for questions?
Thank you so much. Sure, we have time for a question. Just want to thank you. I just saw all the paths of USN from 0 point till the launch, and you're doing an amazing job. And
thank you.
So, any questions? No? Are you sure? Yeah, I believe that someone have.
Hey, thanks for the presentation. So the question is, how do you prevent Oracle from running?
Excuse me, prevent what?
Oracle from running.
I think we've got somebody who can explain a little bit more about oracles here. It's really important to understand that initially in USN V1, we had a pretty complicated Oracle with at least few layers of defense against front running. Currently, we're in a transaction phase where we're moving away from phase one with the Near and USDT towards fully USDT collateralized and then a basket of stable coins. So currently, the minting happens one-to-one without usage of Oracle, but we're on our way of developing a really nice solution with the help of the whole Near community that will be defended from front running on several layers. But to be clear, that is the extremely important point that we're considering from the very beginning.
Thank you. Any more questions, guys?
Obviously, USN.
What? I'll pay you later.
Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, guys, we will proceed like in 1 minute. We have next speaker. Just need to reconnect everything after electricity get down. So we're trying to get back in the YouTube stream. I think everyone already has sound, but we are still can see a picture.
It's an eye. Yeah. Hi, everyone. Thank you.
Okay, I'm ready to present you our next speaker, Didier Pironi, product manager of Ref.Finance, with talk Reflections on DeFi, 6 months predictions. Welcome.
Hi, guys. Thank you. Yeah, hi everyone. My name is Didier. Very excited to be here. I'm the product manager of Ref.Finance, which is the first automated market maker built on Near, and one of the top in the top 15 DEXs today with 250 million in TVL. So I'm going to try to talk about
well, that's slow.
Speaking of Near, right, which is one of the fastest layer one protocols. So one protocols. So I think this graph interesting because when we have a look at real demand for DeFi protocols, which translates into, well, trading volume, well, DEX volume is, you know, taking some shares in the overall market compared to SEX volume. But still, it's still very low, right? Because when you use Binance, for example, it's so fast. So when we build DeFi things, I think one of the top things to think about is user experience. So what's next and what I'm excited about? The first one is proof of acknowledgement, right? How many in your life, I do accept or I confirm certain things you've signed, right? Thousands, if not hundreds. And why is that? Because you want to give a clear consent of, well, I do understand that if this protocol is hacked, then I'm going to lose my money, right? So I think this is a great example of what will happen within the DeFi space, right? Because we can, for example, if we have an ombudsman within the space that collects every standard for proof of acknowledgement, then we can basically give access to the product if those addresses have signed like a consent. Even better is proof of aptitude, right? If I want to use like a derivative platform, then do I know what's leverage, for example? And let's say, well, I'm going to do this test on-chain, and this test is going to be recognized on-chain. And I think that opens a lot of possibilities, right? That will reduce the gap between what's happening on-chain and the real world. And I'm very excited about this. And even for insurance protocols, right? Because you can basically say, well, this user, I'm going to have a discount for him because I know that he knows how to use leverage, for example, or he's going to pay a premium because he hasn't passed this specific test, right? Another topic is smart incentives. Well, Vitalik has been talking about it for months now, and generally speaking, a case against CBL attacks, right? Which is the ability for someone to game the system by creating, you know, thousands of addresses, for example, to claim an airdrop. So I think right one of the investors of Ribbon Finance managed to actually get 2 million in ETH by doing CBL attacks. And then because they've been exposed, they returned the funds. But this is a major topic, right? How can we improve the incentives? And basically the faster is the blockchain, and I mean, yeah, the faster is the blockchain, the more we will have these kind of CBL attacks because the cost of doing that is quite low. So I was talking to Mark, and for USN, I think there's a great example. For example, having a look at all stablecoin users on Near that haven't used USN yet. and there are 5,000 at the moment. So that's an example. Or those stablecoin users that have used the bridge if you want to incentivize users coming from Ethereum, for example. So I think this is coming for sure. Another one, everyone has heard about it. Obviously, it's real-time finance. So I'm getting my salary in stablecoins, but I would be very interested in getting my salary in real time. So everyone knows Sablier on ETH, for example. We have Roketo on NEAR, and basically the ability to stream salary, I think is a very cool topic because you want to, you know, take advantage of your money right now. The second one is, and I really love this quote, the slogan of actually Dune Analytics, the future won't be reported quarterly, and the ability as a protocol to give you profit and loss you know, in real time, or you balance sheet in real time. I think that's the future, right? So we are building this at Ref.Finance too. DeFi as a bridge versus as a purpose. So I think the more protocols we have within the ecosystem and the more legal money, the more DeFi will be used as a mean to get something, right? So for example, Sweat Economy is building this world-to-earn system. And I think those users, they will use DeFi maybe to just swap their sweat coin for a stable coin, or maybe you will use DeFi to pay institutions, for example, or service providers. So DeFi as a bridge instead of versus as a purpose. The other one is business-to-business focus. So I think this one is a good example. At NEAR, there is Calimero, which is a private shard built on top of NEAR. And I'm excited about this one because we can build like many pools for institutions on this private shard. And basically, they will have, you know your customer with institutions. The funds won't be mixed with retail customers. So we can basically, develop solutions for businesses on chain. And the last one is capital efficiency versus TVL. So everyone is obsessed with TVL, but we've seen that with Uniswap concentrated liquidity, for example, they've managed to increase capital efficiency by a factor of 10. So this is something we are really focused on at the moment. And I would say all those seven items are what I think will be next for 2022. Do you have any questions, guys, on that? 80% of the swap commission, Ref.Finance will still have a referral fee to do that. So, I think I only see positive things with more protocols coming.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions, guys? No? Seems no. Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. Just before we proceed, I wanted to remind you that you can get some airdrops of NEAR tokens on your wallet. It's upstairs. We have quiz. It's NEAR Darn Club. So you can choose a card, and it's like kind of lottery. Just check it out. And also we have a puzzles. It's like brain twister, so you need to solve the puzzle, and you will get an airdrop of your tokens. And I'm just going to check if we're ready to our next speaker, and we will proceed. Are we ready? Perfect. And I'm happy to present you our next speaker, MJ, Head of Product of Proximity Labs, with talk DeFi on NEAR. Welcome.
Thank you. Bonjour. Comment ça va? Just a quick heads up to all the friends here who do not speak French, since we are in the beautiful Paris right now. So this presentation will be delivered in Mandarin Chinese. I'm just kidding. Hi everyone, my name is MJ. I work at Proximity as well. So today we're going to talk a little bit about DeFi on NEAR. And before we get started, just a few quick words on Proximity. So Proximity is one of the many ecosystem funds on NEAR, and we are specifically focused on the DeFi ecosystem. And as an ecosystem fund, there are usually three things that we aim to achieve. Number one is supporting talented teams and developers who may want to built on Near, right? If that sounds like you, and if we have not talked before, we would love to set up a chat. And we provide both monetary and non-monetary support, including but not limited to technical advisory, community building, fundraising, and so forth. And number two, Proximity is also a research and development firm. We have a very solid engineering team in-house, and we basically research, develop, and publish open source solutions to some of the challenges in the ecosystem. For example, if you have attended or watched the consensus conference from last month, you probably have seen a demo using MetaMask to control a Near wallet and interact with one of the DeFi apps on Near, right? And that's actually an experimental project from Proximity. And finally, as an ecosystem fund, we work very closely with all the key participants of the ecosystem and try to build an ecosystem as robust as we can. And there are actually a few of us here at this event, so if you have any questions about Proximity, about our programs, or about the DeFi ecosystem in general on Near, feel free to come find us and we would love to chat. All right, so on to the good stuff. Let's talk about the DeFi ecosystem on Near. I would like to start off with some high-level numbers. So just to give you a little bit of context here, about a year ago, when a lot of the initiatives on Near were just getting started, our TVL was about $1 million. And now, a year later, our TVL has peaked over $2 billion. And there are 47 DeFi projects that are currently being tracked on DeFi Llama. And a year ago, there was just one. Take a guess, which one was that? Exactly, that was Ref.Finance, our largest AMM on Near. And through the Rainbow Bridge, there were over $3 billion of assets that have been bridged. And this number could be even higher if we include some of the other bridges. So why Near, right? Why would you want to build a DeFi app on Near? So there are a few things. These are just my personal take. Number one is fast finality. So Near has the fastest finality among any layer one blockchains, which is currently between 1 to 2 seconds. And if we think about it, right, this makes a difference if you are building a financial app, because in this case, the speed can really impact your P&L or the usability of your app, right? And number two is future-proof scalability through sharding. So as you may know, Near has a roadmap for sharding, which includes 4 phases. And this really ensures that the blockchain continues to scale as the ecosystem gets bigger and bigger. And number three is flexibility. So Near gives developers the flexibility to choose the language that they are comfortable with, right? For example, you can choose any language that compiles to WebAssembly. Obviously, Rust being the most loved one here, right? And we also recently added support for JavaScript, which is supposedly the most popular language. So we have both the most loved and the most popular language here. You can also use any language that compiles to EVM. Obviously, Solidity being the most dominant one here. You can also use something like Substance on top of a product called Octopus Network. And finally, last but not the least, this could be a little bit controversial, but personally, I strongly believe that Near has the best user experience across any layer one and layer two blockchains due to its lightning fast speed, low transaction cost, best in the class, mobile experience, onboarding experience, and so forth. And this may be something you have heard of already, but basically there is another aspect or another environment on Near, which is called Aurora. So Aurora provides the Ethereum compatibility on top of the lightning speed, scalability, and the user experience provided by the Near blockchain. You can think of Aurora as a Ethereum compatible layer two on top of the Near layer one blockchain, even though technically speaking, Aurora is not a blockchain by itself, it's just a intelligent smart contract. And as an Ethereum developer, getting started on Aurora is as simple as changing your RPC endpoints. All right, so here is a quick snapshot of the Near DeFi ecosystem at the moment. So as you can probably gather from the categories here that the focus of the ecosystem over the past year has really been, you know, laying the groundwork, building the infrastructure, and making sure that we have all the key components that will enable us to build some of the more complicated use cases that we dream of. So we have some really talented teams building AMMs on both Near and Aurora, and we also have three prominent money markets at the moment. And Near has also been investing heavily in different types of liquidity infrastructure, which we believe is key to the growth of the ecosystem. This includes liquidity staking protocols and the liquidity as a service protocols and so forth. And finally, you may be aware that there are also three order books that are in different phases of launching on Near, which I believe could be the biggest differentiator for our ecosystem, and also they also demonstrate the power of the Near blockchain. All right, so on to the automated market makers. As I mentioned, we have some really talented teams building AMMs on Near and Aurora right now. So Ref is the first and obviously, by far the largest AMM on Near native. And despite the current market that we are all aware of, Ref continues to hit all-time highs in terms of TVL. And their TVL actually grew 3 times year to date. And also it's worth mentioning that Ref also recently announced their V2 tokenomics, which I think is quite interesting because it evolves from the original VE token model pioneered by the Curve protocol. So if you're into tokenomics, definitely take a look. And then we also have Tricellarius, which is the largest AMM on Aurora. And they also have been continuously growing. And they also recently launched a stable swap, which is getting more and more traction. And one thing I found very interesting is that Ref recently launched a new feature that aggregates the liquidity on both Ref.Finance and Tricellarius, right? So this enables users to trade in both environments within a single place, right? I think this is a very exciting first step that demonstrates the composable future of our ecosystem. And we also continue to see projects of really high qualities launching on Near. For example, we have Jumbo, which is now live on the Near mainnet, and also Curve recently launched on Aurora. And onto the money markets, and as I mentioned, we have three prominent money markets at the moment. Bastion is the largest one on Aurora, and they have crossed 550 million in net deposits at the peak. And they also launched a stable swap recently for their C tokens. If you're not familiar, basically C tokens represent users' deposits in Bastion. And I think this is very interesting because now users can easily swap their C tokens using the swap, right? And in addition, they can also use their C tokens and to provide liquidity in a stable swap to earn additional APYs. And I think this is a very interesting development because it expands the use cases of typical money markets. And we also have the other two, which is Burrow and Origami. So Burrow is the largest and the first money market on Near Native, and Origami is on Aurora. And they have also both topped 500 million TVL at the peak. So as we all know, decentralized money markets is one of the key foundational building blocks of a DeFi ecosystem. So I think the growth here is just the beginning. And also, as I mentioned earlier, Near has been investing heavily in different types of liquidity infrastructure. And it's really exciting to see that a lot of the groundwork has been laid on really early in the process. So now we already have two live liquidity staking protocols, Metapool and Linear. And we also have two on the way, which is Lido and Stater. So speaking of Stater, I actually believe they are very close to the launch in a matter of days, if not weeks. So Metapool is the largest liquidity staking protocol at the moment. And despite the current market, their TVL continues to grow in near terms, which we consider the more important term for a liquidity staking protocol. And we also have Rift, which is one of the first liquidity as a service protocols in the entire market, not just on Near. And Rift has been working very closely with some of the projects on the Aurora side, basically helping teams and projects to bootstrap liquidity of their tokens. So this is really exciting to see because this is the kind of the infrastructure that will really enable our ecosystem to grow as it gets bigger and bigger. And also, as I mentioned earlier, there are three order books that are coming to Near. So first we have Tonic and Spin, which are already live on the mainnet. And I think Spin also recently launched perps trading on the testnet. And we also have Orderly, which is currently live on the testnet. And you may have heard of this already. Orderly also recently announced a $20 million fundraise from some of the key participants, key supporters of the ecosystem. And their first app will be in the Wu network, which is contributing heavily to the project. And it's a very interesting technology, geared towards market makers. Basically, they have, off-chain order matching and on-chain settlements, a very interesting design pattern. So definitely keep an eye on these three projects and teams as they, continue to grow and contribute to the ecosystem. And you've also heard about USN, which is the stable coin for the ecosystem. And they have been growing, steadily and strongly, which recently crossed 100 million mark in total supply. My numbers, it can be a little bit stale here, by the way. And the number that I am mostly excited about is that the liquidity between USN and USDT on Ref.Finance has actually exceeded the total supply of USN, which to me is a very healthy indicator that shows the growth here has strong community support. And personally, I'm very much looking forward to the to what's next for USN and seeing it getting integrated deeper and deeper in the ecosystem. All right, so as you can see, the focus of the ecosystem over the past year has really been on building the infrastructure, making sure that all the Lego pieces are in place so that we can continue build on top of this infrastructure. So to me, the next step here is to build on top of this layer and make everything integrated and more usable. So you can see a screenshot from Vaporwave here, which is one yield aggregator on the Aurora side. We actually have a few yield and DEX aggregators coming to Near. And I think it's a very important category of apps that will make everything more usable and integrated. And I also mentioned the three order books that are coming to Near. And we also know that derivatives is the most traded asset in the entire market, right? And while there are some great solutions using AMMs or other design patterns, it's no surprise that the solutions using the order books model have seen the most successes. So we are excited to see the three order books powering some of the solutions for trading derivatives on Near. And we've also talked about USN. So I'm looking forward to more tooling and infrastructure getting built around USN and make everything more usable, more integrated, and more powerful. And last but not least, it's no surprise to anyone that from the very beginning, Near has been investing heavily in different kinds of cross-chain infrastructure, including the Rainbow Bridge, Aurora, and Octopus Network, right? And we are excited to see teams leveraging this infrastructure and building interesting projects on top of it. I think it's it's a multi-chain world, just a matter, it's just in effect. In addition to that, we're also excited to see some of our assets like USN and Near getting used and getting integrated deeper in some other ecosystems, right? All right, so that's a wrap. Just a couple announcements. As you may know, there's a DeFi happy hour tonight at 5 p.m. I think it's on another boat across the river. And there are quite a few of us from Proximity who will be there. So if you have any questions about Proximity, about our programs, or about the DeFi ecosystem on here in general, please come find us. And I think you've heard about this earlier, that NearCon 2022 is also coming in September. This time it will be in Lisbon, so it's the largest, the most attended, and the most lit Near event of the year. I think most of the key participants of the ecosystem will be there. So if you're a developer, we actually also have a Hacker House program at the conference. So if you get accepted, I believe you will get a stipend to cover your trip to Lisbon. Yeah, and obviously Proximity will be hosting a large party there as well. I heard that we have some of the best DJs from Europe, and the venue will be lit. So yeah, so definitely check it out. And we're looking forward to seeing you there. And yeah, if you want to get connected, you can find me on Twitter. You can also find Proximity on Twitter. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Andrei. I think we will have perfect match with our happy hours because ours finished at 5, so we can just move to another boat.
Perfect.
Guys, do you have any questions? Great.
You mentioned you were funding solving the more difficult problems that people were having on your network. What are these difficult problems, or what's the most difficult one you're dealing with at the moment?
Yeah, that's a good question. We can take this offline because it's going to can be quite lengthy. But I think in an ecosystem, there often there are problems that the ecosystem need, but by itself it may not be a profitable product or project. So that's no one wants to build it. So that's definitely one area that Proximity will be looking into to make sure that it could be some kind of middleware-y pieces that are missing in the ecosystem.
Thank you.
Thank
okay,
you.
Guys, I think we're almost ready to proceed. Everything is ready? Okay, I just want to remind you that you have a chance to get 100 euro deposit in Near's workshop. They have like a bunch of cool stuff. You need just to make a photo in front of the boat, post it in your Twitter, and tag Near UA. We will announce the results on the 22nd of July. And I'm happy to announce you our next speaker, Radu Chakon, developer of Borrow DAO, with the talk Supply Borrow Drive. Welcome, Radu.
Hello. Yes, I will present today Borrow Cash. How many of you already use Borrow so far? Nice. Good. So around 30%. Okay, for the rest of you, this is Borrow. So it's a decentralized, non-custodial, pool-based liquidity protocol. So it has all the advantages of Near. It's low gas fees, it's high speed, and has friendly UX. And now I'll do a demo. It's not live, unfortunately. I recorded before because the connection was a bit flaky today. And let's say I have this 13 year in my wallet right now, and I want to borrow some ETH. And I will go to Borrow. I'm already connected here on this account. And I go to deposit, and I will, right now I have nothing in my portfolio, and I start to deposit some near. And I say, okay, I'll go 10 or 20, let's go with 20 near. I will use it as a collateral, so later I can borrow against it. And okay, deposit, it'll take a few seconds and a few cents to do this. And right now I have it here in my portfolio, so I have 20 near. So next I will want to borrow some ETH. So in order to do this, I go to the borrow page and I select the ETH from the pool. I can borrow against around 75% of my initial collateral. Say I get 0.1 near, which is around 40 something dollars at this moment. Okay, approving, and it's done. And I have some ETH in my account. And now the next step for more degen friends, let's do something else. So I already have left in my account around 10 NIR. So I will stake this NIR in Metapool, which is something like, it's a liquidity protocol for staked, like something like Lido on ETH. So I will stake here, let's say 9 or 10 NIR. I'll have like around 10% of API from the pool. I stake 9 NIR. And now I'll have it in my Burrow account, my Burrow portfolio, 9 staked ETH. NIR. Okay, and with this, I can deposit this stake NIR into Burrow, and also I can use it as collateral and borrow something else against it. So basically, I already have my NIR staked. I get some API from Metapool, and also that staked NIR, I have it here in Burrow, and I can borrow against it. And let's say I want to borrow some dollars, some US dollars. So if I go to borrow page, I will see here USDT or and USDC. So let's say I want some USDT, but I'll try to borrow USDC because it's cheaper at this moment. So I'll borrow some USDC. I get like, let's say $50. And confirm, approve, and I will have 50 USDC in my portfolio. But initially, I wanted USDT, and right now I'll go to Ref and swap it for USDT. So I'm here in my Ref account. I will use all my USDC, which is almost $50, and swap it with a very low slippage on for USDT. And it's done. Easy peasy. And I have it here in my NIR wallet, the USDT. And next, let's bridge it to these dollars to ETH native. So I use the Rainbow Bridge, and I have my NIR account connected and my ETH account connected, and I can see that right now it will cost me a lot, $30. To bridge it, if I continue and I choose the USDT and I'll continue, and basically I'll transfer this to my native NIR, native ETH account. It'll take a while right now, a few hours. So that's my demo for today. In 5 minutes, basically, I managed to swap, to borrow, and to transfer from NIR to ETH with very low fees and basically in near real time. Thank you. Any questions?
Thank you so much.
So I noticed the APY is quite high. Is it real?
The APY... in that moment, it depends on the market conditions. It's based on free economics. Basically.
But it's on the mainnet, right? From
yeah,
mainnet.
Everything was on the mainnet, yeah.
Thank you. Do you have any other questions? No, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation.
Okay, guys, we have three more speakers left before the happy hours. So I'm happy to present you George Rakosen, founder and lead researcher of the User Research DAO, with the talk Driving Adoption Through the User Research. Welcome, George.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. Nice to be here. I can see lots of hot bodies, and we're in the coolest bit of the boat, so that's lucky. I'm Georgia Rackerson. I'm a user researcher, founder of the User Research DAO. I'm hoping that this talk is going to be really relevant for people building in the space. So let's get on with it. A bit about my background. I've been supporting the Web3 ecosystem for about 5 years now, exclusively running user research for these kinds of teams. It's the obligatory logo salad here. I used to work at Consensus and now do quite a lot in NIA instead. And my background is in the traditional sense as a user researcher, doing things like B2B, UK government, finance, e-commerce, all of that good stuff. So what I'm going to talk about is the importance of user research for product adoption. And just want to make this super clear to everybody that when we talk about user experience, everyone knows user experience is one of the biggest blockers to adoption in Web3. But what they don't know necessarily is what is user experience. It is not just your UI. So sometimes people get a bit confused with, well, where are the buttons placed? Is it understandable? Rather than thinking about the fact that user experience is about every single touch point a user has with your product, on it, off it, what they do beforehand, the context of the other products that they use. It's also about whether it solves a real problem for people too. Finding product market fit involves actually going and speaking to users. And this is the bit where the user research comes in. Finding ways to validate your ideas. And what does user research look like? What I'm talking about is an interview with somebody, sitting down, having a one-on-one conversation with them in an open-ended way, or observing them use the product that you're doing. And user research is about course correction. Quite relevant here as we are on a boat. So if you imagine your product team and your product is a boat, a ship, and you have a destination in mind, something in sight, you think this is where we're going to go. You need constant course correction in order to get you to your end destination. You can't just expect to set sail and end there. And the cool thing about doing user research along the way is it injects that course correction to stop you wasting time, to save money on all those developer salaries and contract audits and whatever else it might be. And you have this team alignment around a common understanding, which is often an underlooked perspective of user research. The value of coming together and having this shared knowledge that helps you move in that direction. And I promise you, if you do this, you're going to have advantage on the competition. When I first worked in Web3, there were about 10 people in the whole of the world doing user research in the space. That has increased, but most product teams are not doing this. So if you know something about your users and to can validate your product market fit, you're ahead of the competition. And on the note of this course correction idea, you may well find that you get to a different destination, one that you hadn't expected to get to, but actually is more appropriate. So what makes good user research? In these conversations, one-on-one with people, you want to understand what their needs, pains, goals, behaviors are. You might want to observe them using your product, like a demo, doing a Figma prototype, concept testing, in order to identify ways you can improve it. And it's got to end up with a plan of action. It's no good if you do all this research and then you just don't do anything with it. And that is often a failure of teams. But what it is not collecting opinions. Everybody and their dog has an opinion, and this is not useful. Opinions are not based in our real lived experiences as well. So we adopt lots of opinions. Like, for example, let's say your product's main value proposition is it's decentralized. It's a decentralized version of X, Y, or Z. And for a lot of people, they will tell you, decentralization is really important to me. I've interviewed Bitcoin core developers who've like unbanked themselves, you know, so privacy focused, but still use Facebook. right? So you can't rely on people's opinions about this stuff. What you're looking for is their real lived experience to teach you what you need to know. And it's not getting people to future cast. Would you buy this if it was available? How much would you spend on it? These are questions you can't get good answers to. It's much more useful to ask someone about their previous experience in a similar situation and use that to project forwards. I like to use this illustration. I hope you can see it. The difference between quantitative and qualitative research data. So I think this diagram kind of spells it out quite well. This is a bit like a product team launching a product. They put it into the wild and they go, it's amazing. Why wouldn't anyone want to use this? But then you can only find out why through qualitative research. Why don't people use your product? Why are they not adopting it? This is why it's so important to do. Surveys suck. Please don't send a survey as the first thing you do trying to get information from your users. They are ubiquitous. We get asked all the time, complete this survey, tell us how we did. You know, so we've kind of adopted, not we as in Web3, the world has adopted surveys as some sort of really useful method for collecting data. The problem with it is that it's really hard to write a good survey. You are trying to fit people's answers into neat little boxes, and people are messy. It's much better to find out a bit about those users first and then survey at scale later. Another factor on this is that you're quite unlikely to get a very highly statistically significant number of responses unless you're doing something, you're spending quite a bit of money at this effort, right? So I guarantee you, if you have a conversation with five people, you will learn a lot more than surveying 20. So some considerations for working in Web3 that you need to be aware about when conducting any kind of user research or validating your product concepts is that users have an unusual amount of sway in Web3. In Web2, there's a lot better delineation between users and makers of things. But like in Web3, that's Venn diagram, the circles are very close together, and there's a lot of crossover. This means that users will tell you what they think you should be building, especially people in your community, which leads me to my second point, which is that teams should not confuse token holders with users. These are not the same things. And if you only listen to this group of people, you're going to get all the wrong signals, because they're going to tell you what they think you should be building in order for the price of their token to go up, not what is actually going to bring value, long-term value, to a specific group of users who you intend to use your product. One other thing about this as well is privacy. So, you know, can you do user research and ask people all these in-depth questions if they want to remain private? Yes, you can. In fact, it's actually better than doing a survey where you're collecting lots of data that you're not going to store in a secure way and just have, you know, in a shared drive with your teammates. Actually doing one-on-one interviews is a very privacy enabling method, because the user is consenting to tell you the information they're happy to. One thing I would say, though, in my interviews that I do, very often users prefer to have their video off. I always have my video on. I can't be anonymous in the space, and that's because there's no reason for somebody to trust me and give me lots of information about themselves if I'm not giving them something about me too. So here's some tips. If you are designing or building a product, you have a concept, you have something live right now which has hundreds of thousands of users. The first bit for doing any of this validation yourself is finding the right people to talk to. And this is the number one stumbling block for teams. The first thing you need to be doing is defining who that target user is by their behaviors, right? So not it's men who are aged X and live Y. That's not useful for you. It's much more useful to be thinking about the behaviors they exhibit that qualify them as a user for your product. So a Web3 developer working with a particular tool in their stack, or it might be a crypto native user who participates in on-chain governance for a particular protocol. Write write a few questions that will find out if the person answering fits that profile and share it widely. Discord, Telegram, Twitter, find those people. And remember that you need to be considering the user experience for the participant in your research as well. So this means being upfront with them about what's expected of their time, you know, what kinds of questions you might ask them, that you're not going to ask for their seed phrase, that whatever, you know, like helping them build trust in you, and also making sure they know that you're going to pay them. And paying people, it sounds like, oh, why would I pay people for this insight about them? It's the cheapest way of getting really, really valuable data. So if you only talk to five people, which I'm going to talk about in a second, you're going to, you know, it might cost you $300. That $300 will be the best $300 you spend if you do this accurately. So who could you be talking to? Your existing users? Profiled non-users, so these are the people you wish were using your product but aren't. They might be using competitor products. They might hate your product. They might have stopped using it for a particular reason. Going and finding out information from them is brilliant, really, really useful. And remember, be wary of those fans and token holders. They're not necessarily your user. And avoid, I mean, it's a small community, so we all end up knowing each other by a few degrees of separation. But avoid talking to people interviewing people you know personally. Get your co-founder, get somebody else to interview that person. If you think that their insights are going to be really valid, you need to do it, just you don't do it, because you're going to have a lovely conversation between friends, but it may not be an in-depth, truthful conversation. So, and you're going to make assumptions about what you think that person is, you know, thinking and feeling, and you might miss some of the nuance that's needed. So, asking good questions. These are just open-ended and exploratory. Tell me about the last time you deposited USN into X protocol. Then what did you do? How did it make you feel once you found the information on the Medium article? Whatever these questions might be, describe to me, show me how. They're really, really simple. Simple words to use that are understandable, and they'll really help teams get to the answers that you need. And I'm just going to talk a few researcher tricks of the trade here. So this is when I'm interviewing somebody. I try and use all of these. The first one is the five whys. This comes from a concept called root cause analysis, which is helping to determine what the real reason is for why something went wrong on the production line. But in interviews, you can use it for really diving down to understand the innate reasons for why people do the things they do, because it probably isn't the first thing that they say to you. This doesn't mean that you say literally why five times. You're not a robot, but, you know, sort of encouraging more depth, basically. The boomerang technique. So this is really useful. Sometimes users or people that you're interviewing are going to ask you questions about the product itself. Well, if I press this button, will this happen? So to avoid explaining anything, allowing them to be the expert, you ask the question back. What do you think will happen when you press the button? And then they'll just go off and continue talking about it. So you put the power back in them to be the authority of their experience. Silence is very important, just like creating space. Sometimes I pretend to look busy making notes when I think there's more to be said and that user hasn't said it. They're likely to fill the gap with their voice. And then, of course, if you can't, you know, you just want to know, you know, did you see that button there? Did you see the piece of information that you really wanted to find out about and they haven't mentioned it at all? You can use the Columbo technique, which is, I just need to find, you know, you try this right at the end when you've tried other things that haven't worked. So, just very quickly, I'm going to talk about user research support for anyone building in NIA. So the user research DAO. We are a group of expert user researchers, all versed in Web3. I've been hunting them down and bringing them into the fold, and we are supported by NIA Foundation to deliver user research support to teams. That looks like office hours, training. We've recently done quite a bit of training for folks. And these are the kind of questions that we can help people answer. You know, about finding product market fit, about understanding how people use our product Why are we not achieving adoption and retention? It's one of the big questions that comes around again and again. What features should we prioritize in the backlog? All useful questions for product teams to know the answers to. Here we go. So we've delivered training for 20 NIA-funded teams so far. We've been doing research for Pagoda, Verida, and NIA blocks. Coming soon, NIA University, Simplify, and a product called Cora as well. So very excited about this. If you'd like to book time to talk with me, you can do about your own product. If there's something in particular that you want to discuss considering user research. And, of course, you can always find me on Twitter, where I am around. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Georgia. I think it's really useful for everyone. So, guys, do you have any questions? Someone? I think everybody a little bit tired. Oh, we have a question.
Thank you so much for your talk, really insightful. My question to you is, what are the best ways to get user research? Do you think surveys is a good maybe first starting point first, and then you go down to like maybe focus groups and then behavioral, I don't know, checking? Like what's the best process of starting to get like your best user research to find out who is the perfect user for your product?
So the question you want to answer is, who is the user for our product, yeah, right? So if that's the case, you have that question, you need to start an internal activity of defining who you think it is. Then you need to recruit 5 people who fit that profile and interview them first. Don't do surveys first. It's not going to answer the question that you want. Focus groups are like really old hat. No one in user research does them anymore, just as a heads up to people. And like, you know, there used to be the time when usability testing was incredibly expensive and people had to build labs to do it. You know, things have changed. It doesn't cost 20 grand now to find out what 5 people think about your product. So there's really no excuse for not doing it.
Thank you. Guys, any other questions?
Oh, hi, thanks for the talk, like, really cool, I loved it. I was just wondering about the user research, though, like, very interesting idea. I really want to get involved. Is it just, like, related to projects backed by NIR, or are you open to, like, other projects that are wanting to build and, like, still a bit earlier?
I think it's testament to NIR's ambitions to be the most, you know, user-friendly and widely adopted network that they've funded the existence of the user research DAO, and it currently exists to support NIA builders, but it's a test bed for a much larger DAO. So what I am building now is a chain agnostic user research DAO that will create publicly available research that will affect product teams across the entire Web3 ecosystem. Because one of the challenges is that research gets stuck in all these siloed companies. They don't talk to each other. And as a researcher, I end up doing very similar research over and over again. Whereas we could just get some funders to fund stuff that will be applicable to everybody. So, get in touch and I can tell you more about it.
Okay, awesome. Thanks.
Thank you. Any other questions, guys? Yeah, I think we're running out of questions. Thank you so much, Georgia. It was really
Thank
nice.
You.
Thank you. Just a moment. Before we proceed to our next speaker, I just want to mention that we will be open like for 2 more days, tomorrow and day after tomorrow. Tomorrow we will have Aurora Day. So we are open at 9, so, and at 12 we will start Aurora office hours, and at 1:30 we will start office hours with Marieke. Also, and 1:30 it will be investor office hours, and we will start with our speakers at 2:30. It will be Alex Shevchenko, CEO of Aurora Labs, Maxim Sienkiewicz, co-founder Atomic Green, Ian, co-founder Origami, Jason Ma, Director of Business Development, Elixir. Zvezdin Besarabov, CEO, Audit.io. And also Marcello Fornet, Protocol Team Lead, Aurora Labs. For sure, we will have happy hours as well. I know that we are sold out on Eventbrite, but you can just come, and I'm sure that we will find a spot for you. So we will just can let more people, depends on our capacity. And now I'm happy to announce our next speaker, Vadim Ilyin, Nir Devrel Tagada. And Vadim will tell about building smart contracts in JavaScript. Welcome.
Hello. Bonjour, YouTube. Smash the like button, subscribe to Nir channel, all that stuff. There's a lot of videos on this channel, and we will tell. Today I will talk about building smart contracts on JavaScript. So, quick introduction. I have some experience in fintech and DeFi. I came to Nir through the hackathon, joined Nir Devrel last year. From this year, I'm working in Proximity as well, which is DeFi Labs on Nir, and build some applications on the Nir mainnet. Probably you used some if you are experienced Nir user. It's a bit outdated agenda, but okay, I will skip it. So what is Nir? Why should you build on Nir? Layer 1 blockchain, which was built by genius developers. Few of them were talked today. And this blockchain gives incredible scalability through sharding. It has proof of stake consensus, carbon neutral, have certification by South Pole, and very fast block finality, 1-2 second production time, and very cheap transaction cost, so only fraction of cents. Okay, we are on the boat if you don't know. So it's interoperable with Ethereum. You can have any data from Ethereum on Nir and from Nir on Ethereum through Rainbow Bridge, which is data bridge. You can transfer any tokens, NFT, actually any data like DAO votes, and you can even run your Solidity code on Nir using Aurora smart contract, which is EVM compatible layer on top of Nir. Nir is building simple, secure, and scalable blockchain, and our major target is 1 billion users in 5 years. And of course, we cannot achieve this without a lot of applications on top of Nir. So we want to make great developer experience. I will talk about it, but before I want to show this screenshot from 2020. I took it yesterday from WebArchive. So before we had all this stuff about foundation, about innovation, Web3, NFT, it was just a blockchain for builders. And if you see, with the most developer-friendly blockchain. So I guess we have some developers here. And could you raise your hand who even wrote one line of code on Rust? Okay, we have some. Who made the code on Solidity? Okay, the same. And who knows at least who wrote at least one line of code of JavaScript? Okay, I think double. So yeah, when we have this challenge between Rust and Solidity, for sure JavaScript it took a lot of. JavaScript is the key point to have onboarding of Web2 developers in the crypto space. This is a story from the Stack Overflow, quite popular. Maybe you saw it. And Rust became the most loved language 6 times in a row. So people who even once tried Rust, they don't want to go to any other language. They want to keep building on Rust. And that's why Nir gives a lot of attention to Rust developers. Nir Core is built on Rust. Our Rust SDK is the most mature, the most real case applications built on Rust and open source, so we can easily on board, and if you want to learn Rust, you can come and build on your application. Another second language is AssembleScript. It also has this compilation to the WebAssembly, so you can use Rust and our assembly script, create a WASM binary, upload it to the Near blockchain, and you are okay. Assembly script is not so popular on the Near ecosystem, but still a lot of, at least two very big projects are built on assembly script, and they also succeed. So, but the most problem here is that this needs some attention for developers to educate themselves to find some new technology, what they don't know. And the same Stack Overflow survey shows that JavaScript is 10 times more popular than Rust. So it always have this first line of the popularity for experienced developers, for the newbies developers. So that's why one team who built on Near, they made this JavaScript SDK because it's a language to have this real mass adoption. Already we have, here we wrote 7 million, but probably it's, I think it's around 10, I saw some numbers, so like 10 million people, they know how to write JavaScript code. It's a very simple onboarding for Web2 developers, like some amateurs, because there are a lot of education courses and a lot of some examples. And also very good reward for this, that you can use the same code and the same code base on the front end and on the back end. For example, if you need some calculation on the front end and some validation on the back end, it can be the same code. You don't need to rewrite it, for example, on a Rust and on a, I don't know, JS for the React application. So right now we have three developer experience on Near. First is native assembly, what we told before about Rust and assembly script. Another is Solidity code. You can create some binary and deploy it to Aurora, and it will be available on Near using Aurora EVM. And JavaScript virtual machine, which I will explain now. You can have your JavaScript code and upload it to the JavaScript VM, and it will be a real smart contract on Near. So we have three SDK right now for assembly script, for Rust, and for JavaScript. As I said, Rust is the most mature. JavaScript is the most is a newcomer. So a lot of features will be built soon. So this is a scheme on how JavaScript contract may work. If you have your dApp, so like imagine this is a website. You send some, for example, some request, like, I don't know, write some message on a blockchain. It goes to RPC, probably using Near API.js, which is a module available on NPM. Then it goes to the runtime layer, and we have a virtual machine for the WebAssembly, and there is a one contract inside this JavaScript virtual machine. It has its own state, it has some code base, so you deploy your code to like a container, and then you can read some data, write some data, and it will be like a real smart contract, but the source of this code will be in JavaScript. So here I wrote the workflow. So you have some JavaScript contract, like a vanilla code. You can grab any code from GitHub. It will be okay. Then you have to compile it and encode to Base64. Our Near CLI can help you do this. Then you can deploy this contract and use it in this isolated environment, enclave, and you can pass some parameters there as arguments and read some values as also and decode them and use in your application. And you will have to attach some Near if you want to rewrite data because of this stake storage concept on Near. So one thing what I didn't tell before, so this JavaScript WebAssembly engine was used from QuickJS. And all the procedure is very similar to Aurora, the workflow how Aurora works. This is schema for Aurora, but you can imagine that instead of Aurora, it will be like a JavaScript virtual machine. So very similar flow. So probably if it will be another popular language, Solidity, JavaScript, maybe something else, we can maybe it will be introduced on Near in the same way how JavaScript and Aurora is working. So the feature about JavaScript virtual machine is that cross-contract call here are synchronized. It's demanded feature for the newer contracts. Maybe we will see new use cases because of this. And you can install, about covering storage I already told, and you can install just through the NPM to your JavaScript application. So here is the QR code where you can find a lot of examples, which I will tell right now, explain right now, and some documentation. So maybe take it if you like it. And let's check three contracts in a short way on JavaScript. So there is a website near.dev with some examples, and one of these examples is a status message. You can just write your status on a blockchain, like your Twitter status, and then all the people will see it, what's going on with you. So here we have a structure of files. One is package.json, where you can see like near SDK.js here. So we can load it from local repository or from internet. And just one code, index.js, with the source code of this message contract. You can build it easily with Yarn. You can test it. So the whole stuff is very familiar for any developer. So this is the code of this status contract. I will just show some highlights so you will be familiar with the stuff. First line, so it's a JavaScript code, as you see. So first line, we have some import from the SDK. We can load some things what we will use below. We have this decorator near bindgen. It is like macros, and it makes a function which we described below available from the public access. So we can call it externally, and it allows to serialization, deserialization the methods and the data in the way how JavaScript VM will accept it. We have a constructor function here. We have on implementation of our objects. So here we will have some hash map records. Then we have two functions, setter and getter, and we have some decoration this is a call function, this is a view function. This naming is very familiar for near environment. So if we have call function, it means this function will update the state, change something in the state, view just return some. So get function is quite simple. We have account ID as parameter, and we return this value of this key from the hash map. If we don't have it, we return null. Setter function is also actually similar. Here we have we request which account signs this transaction. It comes from the system variable near. We imported it here. And signer account ID is account which actually signed transaction. We have set of environment objects imported from this near object. And we save in our hash map message on behalf of this account ID who signs the transaction. This near.log is just a log for a indexer for the explorer. You will see it, like what's going on the user will not have it as a response of your call. This is the link for the environment variable which I show right now. This is a link to the near SDK.js. So you can actually grab any code and put these decorators and upload it to the blockchain. We have a lot of different stuff, for example, predecessor account ID or contract, JSVM contract name, some attached deposits, block height, block timestamp, so you can find it all from the near object. And right now there are three collection included to the near SDK.js, lookup map, lookup set, and vector. Another one contract that I want to show you, it's a bit more complicated, but it's a guest book. So here there is one object, posted message. This object contains three variables, like is this message premium, what text of this message, and who sends this message. So because this is object, we have to make serialization. And this is a function how to deserialize this object from the contract state. Actually, all other stuff is very similar, just you are operating with the object instead of variable. But still, it's very simple JavaScript code. And this is the way how you can work with this smart contract through the NearAPI.js from your web application. So NearAPI.js has a full documentation on our docs.near.org website. The only difference here, you will call not exact the call methods from your request, but you will call method named call.js contract and encode your arguments with some special function. You can find it in the code, this QR code link, and very soon it will be just introduced to NearAPI.js by default. So this is a guest book what I just showed. There is some front end for it, so you can just send some message and see a guest book, for example, for the website. This is the link for the example what I just showed. And one stuff what I made myself when I played with this JavaScript SDK, I made in 4 hours, literally in 4 hours, I made a game. It had very clean backend and contract site. So I just, from the server side, I updated the code and made it smart contract. So it was a tic-tac-toe game, and it was a server side with the logic and the front-end side with the UI. So this is my commit to update the, actually to transform back-end side to the contract. As you see, it's white. So it means I didn't change anything. It's just logic from the back-end of the JavaScript game. So how to find winner, how, I didn't change at all. So just pure logic from existing Web2 application. And I used existing front-end, and it just worked as magic. So this is my tweet, you, also with QR code, you can even play this game. So this is the power of JavaScript VM. I'm out of time. This is the slide about difference with Solidity. Probably we can skip it. More things to come. We will have near standards implemented soon. Some cross-contract functionality is coming. Native support from internal tooling is coming. So just stay tuned. Now I will show some resources which probably you will need if you will want to write some contract on Near. Docs.near.org is the global database for all our documentation. There is a search there. You can find through all the support websites any topic you like to find. We have near.dev is a database of existing examples. Most of them have UI and contract with all comments and documentation with the full README. So really spend some time, play with it. There are useful and some meaningful examples there. Explorer, probably you will need it to test your transactions. Wallet, you can create it on testnet for free. Play where, you will have some tokens inside, and you will be able to test your code. Near CLI, if you want to submit some transaction from your computer, I think all operating systems are supported for sure, Linux, macOS, Windows. Near API.js is our library to work to support UI. So you can create vanilla JS or React or any Angular, Vue, whatever you like, and just import it and use it. It will help to encode, to decode values, to send some requests, to receive response, and show it. Another one important stuff, I guess we have developers here, so if you know how to run a node, how to bootstrap a server, you can participate now in our Stake Wars incentive and earn some rewards in Near tokens and get some Near token delegation to your mainnet node. So the reason why this Stake Wars is coming, because we have next phase of our Near sharding roadmap. It brings 300 new validators to the network. And in order to keep this decentralization, we're giving a chance to every engineer to bootstrap a node, play this challenge game. If you, for every challenge you pass, you will have some points. And in the end, I guess it will be beginning of September, leaders of the challenge will just receive reward and receive delegation in your tokens for their node. So they will be able to earn some commissions for the validating near mainnet. This is the link, or you just follow Twitter, Google it, Stake Wars. Actually, the third part, all delegation, I think most of the validator node went through this process before, during Stake Wars 1 and Stake Wars 2. And thank you very much. I'm working on DevRel. Here's the links how to communicate with us. There are office hours, there is a Discord chat, all the stuff from the GitHub. We're very open to help you build on NIR.
Thank you so much, Vadim.
Thank you. Guys, do you have any technical or non-technical questions to Vadim? Anyone? No? No questions? I think your presentation was just perfect.
Yeah, just reach us from the... Our DevRel team can reply anytime.
Thank you, Vadim. Okay, guys, just wanted to remind you that we will be open today as well. I know that we are sold out and event ripe, but you can just come and then we will find to try a spot for you. I think we will just let people in on our capacity. I'm sure we will find a place for you. Our doors are open from 9 tomorrow. We will have some office hours with Aurora, with Marieke, and also with the fund. So join us, and we will have a lot of speakers from Aurora. And now I think we're ready to proceed to our last speech, which I exactly want to hear, because it's about education, which is really interesting. And our speaker, Sharif Abushadi, near Foundation Education, and talk past, present, and future of education in the near ecosystem.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. How are these slides going to work? Okay. Good. So they just told me backstage that we have we're way ahead of time, way ahead of schedule. So I've got about an hour and a half to fill. I'll take it slow. I like to hear myself talk. I know Maggie is a fan of that. Thank you so much for sticking with us all day today. It's been an epic boat tour with the rocking and everything. I wasn't sure how I would handle that. Looks like we're doing well. After Vadim's presentation, where we saw all of that code, you might be thinking to yourself, I can do that, in which case you should immediately go and do that. But if you're not sure how to do that, if you're not sure what that code was about, and you want to learn more about NIR, about how to build on NIR, then you can come to me. And the education team at NIR Foundation. That's what we're working on right now. So this is a brief kind of walkthrough of the past, present, and future of the education programs over the last 4 years. And I want to make this as boring as possible. So brace yourself. In 2019, actually you saw some slides from late 2019 and early 2020 with Vadim today, which is such a treat to see those slides still working. We were focused on documentation and exploration, so a lot of the time that we spent early on, pre-mainnet launch, was really just engaging with the core developers on the platform. So literally sitting down and interviewing some of the developers and asking them, you know, how did you build this? How did you think about this? Can you explain this? Can you explain that? And there was a lot of that kind of deep, deep spelunking. We had the luxury at the time of having you know, access to developers before some of these core developers went on to start other programs. And so based on that depth of knowledge, we built out the documentation, docs.near.org, currently maintained at Pagoda. And a couple of other bits. In 2020, we started focusing late 2019, early 2020, we started focusing on workshops and events, and so on-demand workshops. Basically, anybody who wanted to give a workshop, anybody who had an event and wanted to include some educational content, we did that. A little bit of certification in 2021, we launched our Near Certified Developer Program and started engaging people in, you know, AMAs, Ask Me Anythings, things like that. And then this year, we are shifting focus now with so many ecosystem projects, shifting our focus to actually attach ourselves to these projects on mainnet and extract lessons learned from the projects so that we can help people who are coming into NEAR speed up a little bit in getting you know, to a viable mainnet launch, basically. So that's the transition here over the last couple of years. And again, I've mentioned some of these links already. You may be familiar with some of these, but this is basically the beginning. And then a couple of workshops. If you're curious what those workshops look like, these are active links. You can go to, I think you can see that, bit.ly/NEAR SDKAS and /NEAR APIs. And then in terms of the content of those workshops, those are fully self-paced. You can go check them out. They're almost entirely still relevant, believe it or not, because the surface area of NEAR hasn't changed in terms of the APIs. They've been fairly stable over the last several years. And so a lot of the work that is here literally is working with very few updates, actually. So that's been incredibly an incredible testament to the depth of thought and the engineering that's gone behind this platform is the stability of these APIs, in my opinion. And so up until last year, we launched NEAR.academy, which is a self-paced course, basically an introduction to NEAR in a lightweight sense, and then launched the NEAR Certified Developer Program. Has anybody here taken the NEAR Certified Developer Program? Are there any NEAR Certified Developers in the room? Yeah, right on. It takes senior devs with about 5 to 10 years experience, maybe half a day, to learn enough about NEAR to build and ship a working demo on testnet, which is a bit shocking for people coming from other ecosystems. If you're a junior developer, maybe coming out of a coding bootcamp or less than a couple of years of experience, it might take you a week or 2 weeks to get your head around what's going on. But it's safe to think of everything as basically a serverless function with a web front end. So here's what NEAR Academy looks like. And here's what the NCD landing page looks like on NEAR University. And so I'm very excited to talk about where we're headed next. So we've had some good success with the previous content. And I think, you know, as you may have heard Illia mention earlier today, a lot of the work that we've been doing has been kind of isolated, you know, to the platform and so on. We need to break out of that. And so in very much the same way, to take a page from his talk earlier, we are really talking about reaching out to projects that are on mainnet, that are already running, that have spent several months, you know, in the weeds, solving real mainnet problems and extracting those lessons through interviews and conversations with developers, review of their source code and commit history and so on, to get a sense of what they're actually doing to ship these applications to production, and then, you know, capturing that and encoding that into lessons so that people can come in and just you know, save months, hopefully, by learning from those lessons. So that's what's really exciting. That's what's coming up next. And to help us with that, we've gone to AwesomeNEAR. You must be familiar with AwesomeNEAR.com, where they were kind enough to provide us over the last, basically, year and a half, 2 years of visitor data, which categories were the most popular. And so this will be our prioritization, basically. We want to stay focused on the kinds of applications that people are interested in. They also provided us with specific applications that people are clicking on, although I didn't include that here in the slide. If you want to get a sense of how we're going to be prioritizing our work, that column on the far right is a good bet of which projects we're going to come and talk to first. And so you might be wondering, what can you do? Well, you can help us identify some of these top projects that are interesting to you, both ones that are live that you're using and ones that are pre-launch. You can help us translate lessons into other languages. So currently we have educational content in, I think, maybe six or seven languages today, including English. And so the more the merrier. I think we should, as an ecosystem, aim for maybe top 10 languages, top 15 languages on Wikipedia. Makes sense to me. And then maybe you can help us create some amazing examples from the lessons learned. So as we extract some of these lessons, you might be thinking, what else can I do? I'm a developer, I have a team, or I know some developers, or maybe you know a technical writer, or someone who's interested in maybe helping us present some of this content. And so there, you can really help us take that and turn these into lessons. So we'd love your support there. And then maybe building something yourself so that we can come knocking on your door soon enough. Right, you can find us online at near.university. And thank you very much.
Thank you so much for your speech. Guys, do you have any questions? Are you sure? Seems we're running out of questions for today.
Ready
thank
for
you
break
so
it.
Much.
Thank you.
So, I think we're ready to move to our happy hours. Just want to thank everybody who's joined our stream on YouTube. You can find a link for the next today's stream in the same library and in our Twitter. And now we can go to our drinks. It's downstairs and upstairs. So just have some networking, and we are waiting for everyone tomorrow and day after tomorrow. Just wanted to remind you that tomorrow will be Aurora Day, a lot of interesting things upcoming. So join us, and a lot of quiz near airdrops also will be available tomorrow and today. So let's have some networking and drinks. Thank you, everyone.